Hey, this is Tommy Rogers with Between the Baird and Me, and you're listening to Sonic Perspectives.
Hey everyone, welcome back to Sonic Perspectives. This is Gonzo, and today we're going to heavy it up a bit with the guy who sings for Between the Buried and Me. And in so doing, he also proves every day that vegans can indeed be badasses. Turns out that he's also a pretty worthy phone tag opponent, Mr. Tommy Rogers. How's your day going?
I'm good, man. How are you?
I'm doing pretty well, man. Thank you so much for joining us. So, before we get into what Between the Buried and Me is cooking up right now, I would like to touch on your roots. You guys have come a long way from your early days as like an almost metalcore band, and now you guys have been on the forefront of progressive metal for quite a while. Can you tell us about how you got to where you are from where you started?
I mean, I would say, you know, it's just all about growth, man. I mean, we've been a band since 2000, and even though that was we were a totally different band back then, we had a very similar philosophy as we do today, is that, you know, yes, we are a heavy band, but there aren't boundaries for us. You know, we, you know, when we started this band, we never wanted to be pigeonholed into anything. You know, we came from the hardcore community with our previous bands and just kind of how we grew up. But we always tried to kind of have our own spin on everything, and we kind of showed the world that we wanted to experiment and try new things. And I think the more comfortable we got with that and working with one another, you know, in the group, I think we just got better at that, and we got anxious to try even more and more stuff. And I think over the years, you know, we just wanted to really push ourselves and keep ourselves excited. And I think the way to do that is to, you know, constantly challenge yourselves and try new things and see what happens. And, you know, I think as musicians, we've been lucky enough to have the kind of freedom where we can, you know, really write songs that are not normal at all, or write things that normally for a metal band would be totally something that would hurt their career, but in our case it sometimes has helped our career, you know. So we're just I don't know how it happened, but it's just part of our DNA, and you know, we're very grateful that we're able to write the music the way we do,
you know. What in particular did you think was going to hurt your career that ended up helping you guys out?
Well, I mean, there's no particular thing. I think just the way we approach music. I say that in, you know, if a band, I can't even think of a band to, like, if just a straightforward metal band, you know, has three albums that are just, you know, this certain, like if Cannibal Corpse, for instance, phenomenal band, but if they had a slow song or a jazz song or even, or anything bizarre like that, it would just, people wouldn't know what to do. They'd be like, what the hell is this, you know? So that's what I meant, is like, we just kind of set ourselves up to be able to really try these things and not freak people out too much.
You know, you guys made a name for yourselves playing some pretty relentless and hyper-technical and chaotic music that was like almost always turned up to 11.
Yeah.
These days, you've got a lot more experimental, like, you know, and that goes back away, like the country and jazzy moments on Great Misdirect, that you know, the atonal weirdness on Parallax. And that's given way to a sound that seems to take a bunch of disparate styles and make them into one.
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, it's something that's kind of part of us. You know, I don't think any of that stuff is forced ever. You know, it's just when we write, you know, most of us write, you know, all the songs. And, you know, when you're putting, you know, a bunch of people that have very different styles when they write personally together, you know, it kind of creates this hodgepodge of different moods and I guess genres, and I don't know. I think, you know, for us over the years is to make it super, we want it to be really organic and we want it to be very cohesive. And, you know, it's, you know, I think that's what we've gotten really good at is just making, you know, even if we do kind of throw curveballs, I think if you don't pay attention, it feels good and you don't even notice the curveball because of the you know, it's the smooth transitions and the cohesiveness of the parts. Because a lot of the, you know, like you mentioned, the country part, you know, on the Colors record, like even though that part seemed crazy, it's just the melody of the chorus that's in that song just played on different instruments in a different kind of style. So I mean, it's not like it's just a random, you know, bluegrass part. It actually is, it works in the song, and I think that's what's fun about music is you can create a melody and it can be interpreted so many different ways. And I think we've always kind of had fun with that. It's like, oh, you know, we can take this crazy metal part and, you know, play it on an acoustic guitar and it has a totally different meaning, you know?
Mm-hmm. So you guys are going to be dropping the second half of your two-part album, Automata. So Automata 1 came out just a few months ago in March. And they're each only about a half hour long. So you guys have done two-part albums before, but what was the motivation behind giving this two separate releases in such a short frame of time?
Yeah, basically we just wanted to release the album differently, you know, and this album felt like the right album to do it. The last probably four or five albums, we've never had like a moment of space in any of our songs or albums. And this album, we intentionally wrote after Blot. You know, there's kind of like a small silence that serves as kind of intermission, and that wasn't intended for anything, because we did write and record this album as a whole, like one album. But we just were like, man, there's this pause that's right, literally right in the middle of the album. It's kind of, you know, because our songs are so long and our albums are so long, you know, hopefully this will kind of help some people dive into the second half a little bit more than they would if we released it as one thing, because we know not everybody's going to sit there from point A and point B and get through the whole album. So there's a lot of factors, and you know, my personal favorite is that it's 2018, and we get everything instantly. I love being like, you guys don't get it all right now. You got to wait a little bit. Yes. There's something cool about that. You know, I'm not saying this is something we intend on doing every album, but I look at like our music. I mean, you know, I think even the business side of us, we like to try new things and see what happens, and that's kind of what we've done with this.
You know, you guys are kind of in weirder territory than you've ever been before. You guys have been playing with bluegrass for a bit, though, but like, there's that really old school prog rock vibe on Automata 2 that I'm really digging.
Cool, thank you. Yeah, I mean, yeah. Proverbial Bellow, especially. I think that's kind of like the super long kind of proggy song of the album, and yeah, it definitely has that old school, you know, 70s prog thing.
Yeah, and this came up in a discussion. We were talking about Automata 2 on our podcast, Talking Perspectives, a couple weeks ago. And one thing that one of my co-panelists and I really, really honed in on was that song, and especially your vocal delivery, the pick up the phone melody. Just, it's so simple, but it reaches the listener.
Yeah, that was kind of the, you know, with that song, that song took a while for me. And, you know, we did a lot of revisions of that song until we got it in a place where we liked. And when I stepped back from it, there was all this kind of crazy stuff, and I wanted to keep the vocals real simple throughout it to kind of tame the craziness a little bit. Where probably in the past I would have done the opposite. I would have just added to it and made it even crazier. But yeah, I wanted to kind of like somehow make this long, you know, intricate, crazy 15-minute long prog song be kind of sing worthy and, you know, have these melodies that are pretty simple, or even write simple melodies over a 7-8 part or something. And that was kind of how I approached it.
It sounds fantastic. It's, you know, for me, it's definitely one of the, you know, one of the highlights of the record, like all what, four songs of it?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. Voice of Trespass. Please talk to us about that song.
Well, that song, that happened really fast, actually. And it's funny, the main riff is actually a riff I wrote for Alaska.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, it was something I had written forever ago. I had these little shitty horns programmed and stuff. And it's something, you know, none of us really thought about much except for our drummer, Blake. He's like held on to this part for so long. And every album, he's like, we got to use that part. And it just never felt right for anything. So finally, he kind of like took it in his own hands. And he started, you know, kind of piecing together a song based around that riff.
Huh.
And then from there, Dan kind of took Blake's ideas and turned it into this, you know, he helped it really, you know, basically become the song that it is. And, you know, and it happened real fast, but it was pretty cool. I'm glad he held on to that riff, because I don't think any of us even thought twice about it ever. So
it sounds fantastic. You know, like I'd been wanting to ask if you guys were fans of a Diablo Swing Orchestra.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah? Yeah. Awesome, yeah. So, like, you guys and those guys have both played at the Prog Power Festival in Atlanta.
Yeah.
And, like, I was there. I was there when you guys played there. I was kind of wondering, how the response that you got from the Prog Power crowd differs from playing to your own audience.
I mean, it was cool. You know, I think our expectations are a lot different now than they used to be. I mean, when we were a younger band, you know, we just wanted our shows to be bonkers and, you know, people going crazy. And, you know, we've come to realize, you know, as we've gotten older and our sound has changed a lot, you can't expect everybody to be going crazy constantly, because, you know, not everybody is that kind of person. And, you know, that fest in particular is more, you know, it's older people, and, you know, they're not, you know, they're there for just to sit down and watch, which is fine. And you kind of go in expecting that. And I believe we played Colors from start to finish on that. And, it was a good vibe. I mean, if I remember correctly, we haven't played in a while. So it was more like a get back in the saddle kind of show for us. And it was right before the Colors tour. So, there was a lot of nerves that night just because we haven't played that album in a long time. And, you know, it's the first time on stage in a while. So cool. I probably didn't even think about the audience. I probably just was like, get through this.
Well, you guys definitely, like, from the audience side, the audience really, really dug you guys. And you made some new fans. You've been making a lot of newer fans that mostly haven't cared so much about, like, harsh vocals and really, really heavy stuff. You guys are, like, making it into that audience. And, I just thought that you... if you didn't know that already, you deserve to.
Cool. Well, thank you.
Absolutely. You, in particular, joined the ranks of the elite not too long ago when you sang on that last Arion album.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was crazy. I mean, I sometimes forget that even happened. But yeah, it's the people he's gotten on those albums over the years, it's pretty flattering to be on it.
Can you tell us a little bit about that experience?
Yeah, it was cool. It was honestly through Twitter.
Really?
He reached out to me, and I was kind of, it was weird. It was during, I guess, Coma came out, and people had told me that he had written a story that's sort of similar. So when he reached out to me, I was like, oh shit, he's gonna like pull some like you ripped me off shit. And but it was the opposite. He's like, you know, I'm Arion, and I knew his albums. I had some of his albums in high school and stuff. And I was like, yeah, totally, I'll do it. You know, let's do it. And it was cool because I recorded with Jamie, you know, who the band's worked with forever. And you know, but the way he sends his stuff, he basically has these people. He has session musicians record the ideas to send to all the singers or instrumentalists that he has play on the albums. So he sends me these clips of this other guy singing these melodies, and he sends me the lyrics, and but he doesn't send me whole songs. He sends me literally like, okay, this 30 seconds or this, you know, minute and a half of what you're going to sing on.
Hmm.
So it was really weird because you don't have any context, because there was times when I was recording, I wanted to kind of put like my feel on it, but I was like, I don't know what happens next. So it's like, do I build this up? Do I make this real big? So it was really different working on it because of that. It was almost like how I would imagine like being an actor, because you don't know the outcome at all. You're just doing the part, and you know, you hope the song's gonna be cool. And so it was pretty interesting doing it that way. And the more I thought about it, I was like, God, this guy's a genius, being able to kind of piece all this together and, you know, kind of have it in his head and send it to all the right people and have all these. I mean, as a songwriter myself, I kind of tried to think about like, what a pain in the ass it would be to do that. And I was like, I could never. I mean, he's just on another level. So yeah, I mean, it's very impressive, dude. The songs came out great. You know, it's a really cool album, and yeah, I mean, props to that guy. But yeah, it was cool. It was very different for me. You know, a lot the music and the, you know, a lot of the melodies were different for me. But he was real cool with me, kind of putting my own vibe on it. You know, there was things that I would change here and there, and he was very open to that, which sometimes people aren't. So that was cool.
Mm-hmm. Wow. So what's next on the BTBAM docket?
We're doing Summer Slaughter right when Automata 2 comes out in July, and then we're doing a tour of Tesseract in UK and Europe later in the year, and yeah, we're starting to plan 2019 right now, and I got a new record coming out later in the year.
Ooh.
That I finished recorded in January, so I've been done a while, but yeah.
Yeah, tell us about your solo record.
I want to tell you so much because I have some really amazing people on it, like some things that I don't know. I have somebody on it that makes me really happy, but I can't really talk about it yet.
Oh,
and,
no.
Yeah, I'm sorry, but it's cool. It's more of a I don't know. It's probably the weirdest solo record I have. Probably, I don't know. It's very all over the place. I would say it takes you in a lot of uncharted territories for me, and Blake actually played drums on it, which was really cool. As you know, he's a very good drummer. So
yeah, he's pretty good. Yeah.
Yeah. So yeah, I'm really excited about it. It's not like Velcro Kid. Velcro Kid was a mainly electronic album, and this one's more everything. So, okay. Yeah.
And you said that you're trying to get that out by the fall?
Yeah, we're kind of figuring that out. It's all done. Everything. It'll probably be October, November.
Okay.
We don't have a date yet.
Then we will probably talk leading up to that, because I'm really looking forward to what you got up your sleeve.
Cool. Thanks, man.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Well, yeah, I think that does it. Is there anything that you want to add that we didn't touch on?
I think that's it. We've been doing this a while. It's awesome. People are still stoked on what we do. So yeah, thank you.
Oh yeah, we are. And like I mentioned earlier, you guys are, you know, making new fans that might not have been into you before. So
yeah,
I think you guys are doing something right. And you know, and I'm really, really looking forward to what you guys do in the future.
Awesome. Well, thank you, man. I appreciate it.
Absolutely. And I appreciate your patience with me.
No worries, man.
All right. You have a good rest of the day.
All right, you too. Bye.
And that was our chat with Tommy Rogers, singer and keyboardist of Between the Buried and Me. Between the Buried and Me's upcoming album, Automata 2, will be out on July 13th via Sumerian Records. Please remember to subscribe to our podcast in order to get notified of all of our interviews. And don't forget about our Talking Perspectives weekly podcast discussion. And of course, make sure you find us and like us on the Facebooks and the Twitters. And you can also subscribe to us on YouTube. And of course, please check us out at sonicperspectives.com. Once again, I'm Gonzalo Perkele Torquetzalcoatl, and we are going to take you out with Condemned to the Gallows from Between the Buried and Me's Automata 1. Check out later.